Okay. 大家好，因为昨天晚上的时间，我们已经看过了娟琪的电影。那关于娟琪的个人简历，我在这里就不多说了。但是呢，我想请大家看一个她三部片子的剪辑。
So, hello everyone. Because you all saw the Juan Chi's movie yesterday, we don't, and you heard about his his work before. So we don't want to show any more this, but we want to show you shortly some trailers from three of his works. It's very short.
Okay, 刚才放的是居安琪三部非常非常重要的电影的一个 summary， 一个是北京的风很大，一个是诗人出差了，还有一个是巴黎派对，来共同呈现出他整体拍电影的风格。
The three excerpts you saw are from the three movies There's a Strong Wind in Beijing, Port on a Business Trip, and Paris Party. They represent very strongly Zhu Anqi's film style.
那让我回到关于《钻的人》这个拍摄电影的整个中国社会大的生活背景。众所周知，中国是一个发展非常快的国家。 过去一年来，有很多的问题刺激的艺术家的思考和创作，比如说，在我们的国家，最近公民意外死亡无比严重的雾霾、洪水爆发，在梦中的儿童突然就被冲走，狂热的爱国主义、食品安全、社会贫困和社会不平等等，一件糟糕的事情和真相又被另外无关的汪洋所淹没，这就是。
So I'm going back to the film Drill Man. As you know, China is in a, the Chinese society faces a lot of problems, like authoritarianism, social inequalities, nationalism. There were also things like civilians being killed by the police. There is the incredible smog problem. There were children washed away by floods. There's a frantic nationalism. There are food safety problems and so on. And all these kind of problems, they are kind of inspiration for filmmakers like Juan Chi.
OK， 现在呢，我就请电影导演、艺术家居安琪本人来介绍他在拍摄《钻的人》的整个过程。So
now I ask Juan Chi himself to introduce the process of his filmmaking.
那个感谢那个Draft的那个给我这样一个机会，来做一个影片。这个影片的动机呢，就是。 我几年前有这个思路，我觉得就是电钻呢，它是一种不安的一种象征，我觉得就是这个片中的这个人物，他也是带着一种 侵略性，但这种侵略性我觉得其实也和今天的一种就是它不是那样一个非常强烈的一个暴力，它是一种一种平面的暴力，一种弱小的，甚至我觉得也是一种那个存在主义的这样的一个，它关于个人的。我想就是我想我的作品呢，它不是就是一直以来我的作品它不是有一个非常单一的一个立场，一个意识形态。我想它一个呢是我觉得是对于中国的这个现实有些思考，然后有一些呈现，我想也是关于一些人类的命运，okay.
Sorry, I have to translate, otherwise it's too long. So first of all, I would thank the organizers here that they gave me the chance to shoot this film. And I want to say shortly something about the motivation, why I made this. It's a kind of summary of the thoughts I had during the past years about this insecure, disturbed feeling we are facing. The main character is faced not by a strong, open kind of violence, but it's rather something, a violence which is on the surface. It's something rather actual in his actual life, in his individual life. I'm not following with this a kind of simple ideal or an ideological view. I just think it sort of represents Chinese reality.
我自己的工作呢，就是，是一个电影导演，然后也做那个录像艺术和一些装置方面的事情。其实刚才看到的那个《北京的风很大》是我那个第一部电影，然后是用一些过期的胶片拍的，然后。后面的那个巴黎派对是我在巴黎旅行的时候拍的，然后用三天的时间拍的。那我想就是我的这些作品刚才说其实它一方面我在讨论呈现一些中国我自己所处的一个面对的一些现实的问题。另外一方面我想呈现的是一些人个体遇到的这种困惑，我想这种困惑它也是和人类有关系。就像巴黎的派对，这个是我2006年在巴黎拍摄的，这里面一半是法语，一半是中文。那这里面也故事里面也呈现了，就是，就是法国人，他对于自身的处境的，一些不满和一些困惑，
Okay. I see myself as a film director, but I also do video works and installations. And about the three films, you saw very shortly trailers. The first one was There's a Strong in Beijing. Then the second you saw was Paris Party. It's actually a film I shot within 3 days while traveling in Paris. And on the one hand, I want to show the problems we face, the real problems we face, for me personally, but also in a collective sense, the society which faces problems. The Paris Party film I shot in 2006, and it's mixed, the language is mixed French and Chinese. And within this story, I also want to show the feeling of discomfort and also unsatisfaction that French people face also themselves.
那我今年，做的，在三月份做了一个，个人的展览，是一个两个屏幕的一个录像，叫大字，这个大字呢是关于在中国的，新疆，有很大的，有一些在戈壁中用沙漠用石头堆起来的这些字是在1968年修成的，他们曾经是一个秘密机场的一个航标。那这部电影呢，它是从这个大字出发，但是其实我在讨论的是1968年在全世界的这种范围内发生的这些革命事件。就是这些革命是到底是怎么产生的，又是怎么消失的？就是这些革命，1968年的这些革命，也对今天的现实一样还在产生影响。那其实我说这个的意思呢，就是我的作品，我想它不仅仅它可能是从一个中国的一个现实出发，但是我希望能更大范围内的去，有一种开放性去讨论，人类遇到了一些困境。
This year in March, I had an exhibition in Beijing called Big Character. It's a project, it's actually it's a video project about quite special thing, which is that in 1968, in the western part of China, in Xinjiang, there was a secret airport built by the government in the realm of the Gobi Desert, and they built there in by stone huge characters, Chinese characters, which are actually the characters are slogans from the Little Red Book of Mao, slogans like to serve the people and so on. And they're very, very, very big. And my film is departing from this, but as the airport was built in 68, so I actually also want to take into account the whole revolutionary movements which were going on around the world at that time. And although my things depart from Chinese reality, I still hope to show something universal that humankind faces.
我之所以坐到这儿能跟大家进行交流，是因为我在90年代末期在北京大学读哲学的时候就认识了居安琪。当时他放的那一部电影叫做《北京的风很大》，完全是地下电影，要偷偷放行。
And Mianbu, as Mianbu wants to say why she's actually sitting here, it's because in the 90s, when she was a philosophy student in Beijing, she met Zhu Anqi and also saw his film There's a Strong Wind in Beijing, which is really a totally independent film.
And 今年三月份，我很有幸跟居安琪一起合作，为他举行了这个大字的在中国的首映，是在一个高挑的空间啊来进行放映的这样的一个电影。只可惜这个电影在整个播放一个月的过程当中，大概接受了5次的审查，但是最后还是持续下去，一直到结束为止。
So in March.Mianbu showed this project Big Character in spaces in Beijing as a curator. And during the 1 month period which it was shown, they actually became visit 5 times by the censorship authorities. And although it was 5 times, they could still go on showing it.
我就是刚才就说了一下我自己的一些工作，然后那个那我这些的工作其实跟我的这个影片钻的人是有一些创作 方式，创作方式上的一些关联。那其实钻的人，其实那这个钻，我觉得是我们都可以马上去理解到了一个象征。我想这个钻，它不仅是在，如果这个里面的故事不仅是在中国，我也许在瑞士发生，我觉得我们都能感受到这种东西的一种威胁。但是就是另外一方面呢，就是这个钻它本身又成为了一种很荒诞的一种象征。它其实我们看上去它跟枪有点相似，但实际上它也没有太大的一个作用。
Suddenly doesn't work. Yes. Okay. I want to talk about my thoughts when making Drill Man. My thoughts about the way how I create a drill is something which everyone can understand quite easily. It's something this kind of threat that we can understand. Whether in China or in Switzerland, it's a kind of absurd symbol. It looks like a gun, and yet it is not a gun.
这个影片呢是在从北京的最西部的这个山区。一直到穿过北京，然后来到了就是离北京有300公里的一片大海。就是我们的拍摄过程呢，其实就是我们开着车，然后就是一边走一边拍摄，然后那个就是都是完全都是在路上，我们在路上就是。住在路上，然后第二天再拍，就整个的过程它是一种即兴的，但是又是带着一个框架。
对，在学术界可能称为这种拍摄方式是有一些叫游击录像的方式。
Okay. The whole process went like this, that we actually were traveling and shooting at the same time. We traveled from the western, the hills on the, in the west of Beijing, eastwards around through the city of Beijing, and then to the seaside, which is around 300 kilometers from Beijing. And the shooting process was a mixture. We traveled by car. So we would shoot and then stay there and then go on, travel and shoot. So it's a kind of very improvised shooting, and yet there is a frame within all this. And Mianbu added that it's something like you would call wandering camera.
我想可能也不是有一个什么样的概念的定义，就是我自己的从北京的风很大的工作方式是这样的。我的上一部电影，然后那个叫《诗人出差了》，他也是一个人去新疆去旅行，在旅行的过程中，其实就是，不停的在去找着妓女，不停的在去找这个风景，包括钻的人，我想他，我们不是要有一个非常明确的一个故事啊，这个电影也没有什么台词，我想他从山里到海里，他跟自然的关系，他和这个城市化的这种关系，他一些那一他的一种不安，甚至是有些那种破坏，对公共空间的一种破坏，或者是就是他其实就是我们自己的整个的这个工作方式，其实就是这样的一种破坏性的，就是我在，就是那个，我觉得就是， 这种破坏它不是那么强烈的，但是就是它带来了一种这种复杂性。
So this kind of traveling shooting style is actually not a fixed concept I'm following. It's the way I've already worked, starting from the film There's a Strong Wind in Beijing, and also in my film Poet on a Business Trip. It's actually about a poet who is traveling alone to Xinjiang, looking constantly, searching for prostitutes. And also in my film Drillman, there's no clear story, there are no dialogues. This traveling from the mountains to the seaside is also showing destruction, the destruction of public space. And I could even say my work style is sort of destructive, but it's no kind of strong destruction, but rather a complexity.
这个片子的主演，是李冰原，是一位生活在北京的，艺术家，也是一位非常重要的行为艺术家。就是这是我和他合作的第二部影片，在之前的那部电影里面，他扮演一个失踪的警察。
The main actor of the movie is Li Bingyuan. He is himself an artist, actually a very important artist in Beijing, and it's the second time we work together also. He also acted in the film called The Missing Policeman.
Li Bingyuan是一位行为艺术家，然后他做的很多艺术的行为也是2000年之后中国最重要的一些行为艺术，包括他在北京的街头在深夜裸体的在那奔跑，然后他在北京的地铁里面带着脸盆带着牙刷在地铁里面进行刷牙洗脸，这些行为都让他在今天的中国当代艺术里面变得非常重要。
Li Bingyuan, this actor, he is a performance artist himself. I would say he is after year 2000, he should be considered one of the most important performance artists. He did, for example, a project where he was running naked through the streets of Beijing during the night, or then he would go into Beijing's subway taking a wash basin with him and toothbrush, and he would wash his face and brushing his teeth in the subway of Beijing.
这个那我的这个电影的这种出发点和观点，我想跟那个李冰原本身的一些创作的方向也是有一致的地方，所以我们的这个合作呢是非常的默契，而且在拍摄的过程中，其实在拍摄这样的一个片子，其实它需要很大的勇气，其实非常的危险，我想也只有李冰原能和我一起来分担这种危险。我们在拍摄的过程中，那个一共被抓过两次，但是还好没有太大的问题。包括这个钻，当我们就在北京的周边，就是你进入北京，它需要很多的一些那个设的一些关卡。然后他们这些就是需要要去查你的车，当我们从北京的西边到北京的时候，我们在路上被查，然后我们当时放了有三把钻，还有20多个钻头，当时就是把我们全部都叫下车，然后让我们要写一个证明，那我们说我们其实是在做装修。
So my starting point in my artistic starting point is in this movie is actually very closely related to the art of the actor Li Bingyuan. And the way he acts in this movie actually required a lot of courage from him. It's actually something quite risky. And I think only he is the person who could do that. He was arrested twice. And when we were traveling and shooting this film, actually, it was also not so easy. We were controlled several times. Our car was controlled. We had to give up 300 screws to leave to the controlling authorities. We had to write a explanation that we were doing reconstruction things and so on.
在影片中我们也拍摄了一些那个在中国所谓的鬼城这种房地产的过度的开发，但是这些楼房也都没有卖掉，然后那在我们在拍摄在一个鬼城的时候，然后就是当时被这个房地产公司可能大概有二十多个人围住了我们。对对对，就是因为我们做专门去拍了这些鬼城，
And actually, we shot, as you could see, we shot in a lot of ghost cities, like places, construction sites. These were buildings that had not been sold and just left over there. And there we were also surrounded several times by people from there.
就是差不多，这就是我的一些创作的一些过程和背景。然后那个我，再希望到时候跟观众再交流一下。
So that's actually all I would like to say about this movie and the way we shot it. And I hope very much that we can communicate about this with you, with the public.
And actually, at the beginning, I would like to ask your comment. I'm very curious because, in the context of draft, you translate. Oh, should I speak more? Oh, okay, because it's different. In the context of draft, yesterday was raised very interesting debate in regards to show in Hong Kong. How far the establishing exhibition venue, it's kind of conventional wide cube in quite expensive area, could be considered as a kind of public gesture. And what kind of new public publicity, publicality, I don't know, it can produce. So I would like if you maybe comment in regards with your film and in regards to its distribution, copyright, and how you see this film as a part of public debate in China and how it can be provoked through that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Dimitri 昨天他在那个香港项目的范围就看了完全不同的事情。我总结一下，他看比较普通的在香港用公共领域的一种项目，而是他想知道你这个项目是在中国会有怎么样的对公共领域的怎么样的贡献这个关系。
就是我想就这个他的这些就是这些作案这些行为其实就是跟公共关系的就产生了我不知道我觉得我可能不会去想没去想的这么多我想就是影片中呈现的其实就是跟公共关系的一些 一些关系，我不知道怎么讲。对
Actually, I don't really know how to say that because I haven't really thought about that. I think the action of drilling actually is related to public sphere.
Before we go to comments, any more? Nikolai, would you?
Yeah, we have a few more comments.
Thank you. And then we'll go to Zheng Bo.
And observations, and like, just consider it as a comment, not even as a probably
okay.
a problematization, but still it's there, obvious, three scenes, or maybe a little more, that the film is quite well structured in terms of interaction with different types of reality. Sometimes in public space, there are public toilets, there are private spaces, there are people, and people are like, again, divided in two categories. One is highly sexualized women, the other one is poor, the poor people. Highly sexualized women. Then the poor people that are outcasts of the society, and the drill man goes and interacts with them. Then there is nature.
Stop, please, a moment. Yeah. I would like to process this. 他看的是，他想说三件事情，可能多一点。他觉得你的电影的结构很清楚。他看有三种事情，一个是公共的东西，还有私人的东西，还有人。人里面它分成非常性别性的一些人还有贫穷的
Then there are three places in Beijing that are recognized as places of power that he doesn't interact with his drill, right? So there is a church, a temple, and a mosque. So this is one observation, right? So he doesn't interact there. He just drinks saint water and whatever. Then we were highly fascinated by the film, the first film, There is a Strong Wind in Beijing that we saw last summer. It's an incredible example of metaphorical interaction and yet speaking about the power relations in the society. When you ask absurd question to ordinary people, passbyers, and this question withholds the problematics in a metaphorical level of the wind as a penetrator, as a strong power. In the film, in the last film, The Drill Man, there is also an instrument of power, a metaphorical one, but in action. So he actually drills. So he represents the power in a way. So artist as a power is like, is there some consideration from the artist himself about these kind of questions and problematics?
The last part?
The last one is like this metaphorical tool, the weapon, is the thing that acts physically. And sometimes it acts against the, not against the power, but rather against the, mostly against the things of the people who cannot answer in the same way, right?
Didn't touch the places of power.
Right, and didn't touch the place of power as religious institutions are.
他可以看到三个地点。三个有政权的地点。你有天主教的教堂，还有寺庙，还有清真寺。他说他上次看北京的风很大，感觉到非常有意思的。你用的这个隐喻，你就去很荒谬的问普通人一些问题，你这样就是有点打扰的感觉，在你这个钻的人的电影里面，你这个政权。是行为这个艺术家他自己就是这个他的行为就是反对可以说 Now, your actual question was...
My actual question is there a critique towards this behavior or towards these actions against the poor and the non-action against the power structures in the last film from the artist? Does artist criticize this kind of behavior?
他那个钻的人里面也有对普通人的一种
怎么说不是损害，就是一种恐惧。他想知道你对这个是有没有什么批判，你自己批判他对人的这种态度吗？我就我呢，就是从我个人来说的话，就是我特别恐惧，就是在影片放完之后，然后去交流。
The thing I fear most is to communicate about my film after showing it.
我想就是他在影片中，他对于那些人，就是一些，比如说有一个什么街头的一个，就是那个可能是，可能是什么智障，然后还有什么卖西瓜的，什么卖菜的，我觉得其实就是，他的这种请愿，其实也是个人的一种那个人希望能得到的一种权利。我觉得就是他本身是一个，我们可以说他是一个反抗者，他也是个受害者，但他同时他也确实是一个。 就是一个破坏者，就是这种破坏，它既来自对于外部的这些公共的人的，其实也是来自对他自己的一种毁灭。I would say.
The aggression the main character shows is rather a quest for personal power. He is actually a protester, but he is at the same time also a victim and also a destructor, the destructor of the public things around him.
Thank you. Olga?
Yeah. I have just a comment maybe. But for me, your film is a kind of combination between power and weakness. Because this drill machine looked like gun, you told it already, but in fact it is not. And the hero wants to destroy objects, but in fact he doesn't. He's doing just small holes, yeah? And it reminds me of the situation of cowboy, you know, with a brand in his hand, and he just stamped, this cow is mine, this flower belongs to me, this old man belongs to me, that homeless people belongs to me, you know, that's, and I think if we can look from this point of view on this film, it can explain us something, you know. This main question, why he drill only things which are weak, because that weak things belong to that person, you know, this drill man, you know. Yeah?
Thank you, Olga.
他在电影里面看的其实一方面是 权力，但是也是弱点，不是电影的弱点，是这个人的弱点。他的工具像枪，但并不是枪。他像一个英雄，什么都想破坏，但其实他也不破坏，他就是钻小小的孔。他觉得有点像牛仔，牛仔的人他就站在那儿说这个牛是我的。 如果你从这个激发点走的话，他的问题是，他为什么就钻很弱的东西？他钻的时候都是很弱的东西，都是属于别人的东西，都是属于弱，比较弱势的人的东西。
我想就是一个普通的一个人，他在其实就是他的这种这种破坏啊，或者是这种压抑，他的这种释放啊，他就是非常有限度的，就是我前面刚才说的过，就是他的这种暴力其实就是不是这么大的一种暴力，他是被压制住了一种暴力，就是这种东西他就是其实就是对自己的一种释放啊。
Well, the main character, he's just a common person. So as I said before, it's all coming out of pressure. As I said before, it's not a kind of big violence. It's violence coming out of oppression. Yeah, that's more or less.
我前段时间看那戈达尔在说自己电影，他说那个我电影中的这个人物都是一些病人啊，我想也是这样的啊。他说他电影中的人都是一些病人。
I recently saw a film by Jean-Luc Godard, and he said therein the characters in my films are all sick people.
Okay.
But I'm really curious because actually it was not answered. The meaning of that scenes in sacred places. Is the guy really belongs to worshipping all that religions? What's the role they play in the film? Because for us, maybe for as Westerners, it's not really clear. Because the whole other narrative is pretty clear, but here we have a break. And what's the break for?
他好像回忆自刚才这个问题，关于宗教这三个跟宗教有关系的教堂、清真寺、佛教。他说，作为西方管者，对我们来说是个中断，我们不太清楚这是表达的是什么呢？他是不是真正的在信仰？
就是他去了这几个地方，就是，我想就是我现在来解释的话，我觉得也都是可能有点过度的去解释它。
If I explain that, maybe it's a bit over-explaining.
但我想，如果可能说是有一个意义的话，其实我们有时候就是这种，他一样，他去了三个地方，但是这个其实也是一种信仰的迷失。
Well, it's like a myth of faith. He's going to three places, but it's symbolizing the myth of faith.
就包括他也去了天安门，但是我们都知他也没有钻，也不可能去钻。但是就是不管是在天安门还是在这些寺庙，我想他的包里面都装着一把钻。
Well, he's also going to the Tiananmen Square, he's also not drilling there. So no matter whether he's going to the churches, the temple, or Tiananmen Square, he's not drilling. But his drill machine is still in his bag.
那这个时候，其实他的这个钻本身又是很苍白的，很没有力量的。他这个钻也许它不是一个真实的钻，这个钻哪怕是在包里面，或者是在他的心里面，这个钻它变成了一种抽象的存在。
His drill is actually something abstract. It's 刚才你可以再重复一下吗？
就是
抽象的东西，我说了。
就是这个，我想这个就在这些空间里面，在这些都有权力的空间里，其实这种钻它也是没有力量的。
So his drill actually in these places has no power, no force. It's a kind of abstract tool.
但这个钻呢，它藏起来了，但是它是存在的。
It is hidden, but it is there.
I just wanted to comment because in Russian situations, the first thing which people would do in that situation, they drill the places of power. They go to the church, they go to the mosque and drill something. That's it.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, that's great. Thank you very much, St. Petersburg. Zhengbo, would you like to? Zhengbo will move between both languages.
先用中文说，然后待会儿再直接我自己翻英文就好了。OK， 很高兴看了，其实因为之前没看过，很高兴看这个片儿，然后也看了之前的片儿。然后我觉得刚才他们都谈到了一点，就是关于我其实刚才这个讨论主要都在谈这种无奈，或者是这种沮丧啊等等。但我在想说，能不能把这个话题再稍微撑开一点？其实我因为我自己看你的片儿的时候，我觉得那个时间是很有意思的。就是我觉得你把整，因为这个国内变化，就像你刚才说，国内像棉布也说，就国内变化非常之快，但是整个片子的节奏也好，然后甚至于到之前讲那个北京分很大，是就是把很旧的片子又重新用，然后再然后又等了很多年才剪，对吧？所以我觉得其实那个时间的那种跟国内的那种时间感觉是非常不一样的。然后我在想说，这种时间的感觉跟刚才所有人讲的这种无力之间的这个关系，我其实我觉得这是我在想的一个问题，我待会儿也可以再就你可以再多谈一点。那我先翻译这一点。OK， 好。So what I think a lot of discussion we had, I think you know, for me, I'm from China, but I think that you know we all feel this anxiety, right? This sort of power but both powerlessness. But I want to maybe open up the discussion a little bit to bring up the question that Nils brought up yesterday about the sense of time. Because in his film, you know, if you live in Beijing, you know the pace is so fast, but the film actually slows down the time, right? And also, in more particularly in the earlier 2000 film, he used expired films and he shot a lot of footage, but he didn't edit them until是多少年？八年之后是多少年之后才拍的时候是九几？对对 ，sometimes he would delay the editing for like 12 years, right? So this, on one hand, we have this anxiety of politics, power, and the other side, he has this slow down time. So I'm trying to open up the question, maybe to bring these two together, and see whether we can come up something.
就是我的这个工作方式，其实也是跟我自己，的所遇到的这个困境有关系啊。这些困境呢，有这个现实中的困境，也有这个精神上的困境。那我其实在我是99年毕业北京电影学院的，到现在其实也有很多年了。然后99年拍摄的第一部影片《北京的风很大》。在这个过程中，当我拍摄了大概就是八九部那个正式发表的电影啊，然后当我自己的工作方式呢，就是我会很机动性的就去拍摄，如果我有感觉了，我要去拍摄，就是那就像我拍第一个电影，我要用一些过期八年的胶片。那就是我当时的现实的困境就是这样的，但是我不能去等待这个条件也许会成熟，但我就要去做。那在这个过程中呢，其实我拍摄了很多的影片，有些影片呢其实我到了很久之后才去剪辑，包括刚才看到的巴黎派对，其实是我在2006年拍摄，然后我其实到了去年才把它做完。那这些通过这些有时候这些时间它就成为了你的影片创作中的一部分。那这些时间它带来了一方面带来了这个影像本身的一种宝贵的东西，第二方面它你产生了你也看到了在这个时间中这个现实的变化和人的变化，就像巴黎派对里面那个法国一个面包师的儿子，他出门他看见就是当时是2005年的时候2006年的时候那个法国那个暴乱门口烧的这些车，他也感受到了这种不安，他说他想离开这个国家。去年剪完这个片子的时候，我们又看到了他这种东西，他对这个现实的一种预言性。我自己也是在这里面产生了一些变化，我觉得就是在这里面他也给我给了一些启发。就是 我想就是这个时间它就是在发酵这些东西，而就是另外一方面就是我现实中就是有些片子我拍完了以后其实我没有钱去剪辑，我也是在到了一个时候去剪辑，因为剪辑需要确实需要有一个安静的时间，所以我现在我最近在剪辑的一个片子是我4年前拍摄的，我就差不多是这样的一个工作方法和我的一个思考。
So there are several aspects to this time question. So on the one hand, this is certainly related to some personal challenges I face. Personal, really individual challenges. I graduated in 1999 from Beijing Film Academy and then shot my first movie. Since then, I have shot 8 to 9 movies which can be called released. My way to shoot, to choose when to shoot, is actually very spontaneous. I don't wait until the moment is ripe to shoot, but I just think when it's when I'm ready to do it, I will just do it. I often edit my films only later. For example, the film Paris Party was shot in 2006, but I edited only last year. And this time thing then also is a kind of inspiration for me. As example for the film Paris Party, when we were shooting it, there were riots in Paris, and when we were editing it last year, we realized what actually changed within this time. This whole transformation happening during this time change then also becomes part of this artistic process. And a further very practical reason is that very often I simply don't have the money to do the editing. So that's also a reason why time elapses.
实际上刚才朱元奇先生讲的是他在这些年来创作的整个的工作方法和生产方式。而实际上呢，对于朱元奇这样一个非常敏感的艺术家和电影人，他所关注的社会现象和问题都是在社会生活当中特别敏感的问题。比如说他的这个拎着钻的这个人到了一个就是没人买的房子，或者说叫烂尾楼，那这个他这个问题呢就影射出来中国的房地产过度开发。另外呢，刚才那位穿红衣服的先生提出来说，他去一会儿去清真寺，一会儿去教堂，这是一个信仰问题还是一个什么问题呢？我想，朱元奇在特别年轻的时候也是一个诗人，因此他在拍电影的过程当中，往往是找到一个非常重要的隐喻，钻就是一个重要的隐喻。但是我想说的不在这一点，而在于什么呢？就是大部分中国人都生活在一个非常没有安全感的状态当中，非常焦虑，非常无力感。那么每一个中国人当他要面对现实生活的时候，他去到教堂也好，清真寺也好，或者是观音菩萨也好，实际上他是求得一种内心的安慰而已。这个貌似跟宗教没有关系，但是跟中国的社会生活是非常有关联的。所以这些点儿都被朱元奇特别敏感的这样的一个触角给挖掘出来。
Okay, what Mianbu would like to add is about the production mode and the way Zhu Yanqi works, is that in all his films he actually touches very sensitive issues. For example, what you see in Drill Man, these ghost cities, it's actually a very direct result of the excessive real estate market in China. So that's a very sensitive topic. The church, the temple, the mosque, of course, it's the religious aspect which is very sensitive in China. And I would also like to point out that from the start, Zhu Yanqi was also a kind of poet, as he used poetic metaphors in his films, and then I would also like to stress another thing is that you really have to know that the majority of Chinese people is actually feeling or living in a very insecure, very powerless, and very dreadful environment. And so the scene with the churches and the temples, I would say you can also see it the way that no matter to which kind of religious institution to go, it might all give you a kind of inner consolation.
Thank you very much. Zhengbo, and then we will have just three comments. Yeah, thank you.
其实我就想回到刚才说那个不安和时间，其实我自己看的话，我觉得其实你这个工作方法其实是非常重要的，因为我觉得恰恰是觉得说这个不安是因为这种非常急速的变化，就不我在想其实不只是普通人，其实政府也非常的不安，我觉得恰恰是因为你可能自己这种把它这个时间放慢，才让有这么强的自信来去对抗这个不安，这是我其实我刚才想带出来的，我解释。So back to what I was saying about the anxiety and pace, I actually think it's quite important that he slows down. Because, we talk about how normal people feel very anxious. I actually feel the state, the Chinese government is also always very anxious. I mean, the security people are very anxious. So everybody's very anxious. So I think the way he slows down, the way he works with these films is actually very important to resist this anxiety. So that's why I think going back to time, I actually think that's a very important artistic strategy for me.
Thank you very much, Xingbo. Thank you. We have just time now for three comments. Nils, Giorgio, and then we will close with Quatemo because we have to keep the day moving. So, Nils, do you have a mic? Yeah, thank you.
Natalia, thank you very much for helping us so much in translating everything. The comment I would like to refer to Olga. Olga gave us a bridge. She understood the film as a representation of a hero. And I think that I would like to comment on that and to perpetuate the hero that starts, or the young prince who has to go in a foreign country and to make strange things that he doesn't understand, but somehow he has to do something. And this leaves with us a certain kind of desperate situation, but on the other hand, one has the impression that the prince or the actor or the figure is a machine, a robot, which is only acting following a program prescribed to him, not developed himself by himself.
Thank you, Nils.
And just a question, if we have time, are other people paid? For example, the women in the dancing?
Thank you, Nils. Natalie, can I ask you, if you could take the comments and then when we have the break for the setup, you could tell them.
I prefer now, because I only take short notes.
You sure?
In 10 minutes, I don't know them anymore.
Okay, let's do it. We have to really move, yeah? Okay.
他就像跟 Olga 刚才说的做一个连接，他想提这个英雄的概念。他觉得有点像一个年轻的王子到国外去要做什么项目，而且有点失望。他像一个机器人，他其实不自己动作，他就是有一个像一个软件，让他行为。他的问题还是很实际的问题是，你在电影里面的这些人，他们收过钱吗？就像那个跳舞的女人什么，你给他们付钱了吗？
那。就我的这片子工作中，就是有时候给钱，有时候不给钱，有些给钱，有些不给钱，就是这个有时候给钱，也是其实反而破坏了那个工作啊。
The question about the money, sometimes I pay them, sometimes I don't. Sometimes when I pay these people, it actually destroys something.
Thank you. Giorgio, and then Quatemo, yes, to close here.
Just very briefly, also as a way of showing my appreciation for your work and not just this film. In answer, I'm not trying to sort of outsmart you or anything, but you know, I don't know whether Nicola or Dimitri asked why you don't drill in the church. That's a reflection, of course, of the production process. If you know, if he had done that, the film would have stopped, right? So it simply reflects actually the circumstances of production, it seems to me. And I really love the way in which your work folds the circumstances of production and the production process into the film itself. Two images that stayed with me, of course, are him engaging in this mimesis wherever he goes, particularly in the ritualist, you know, in the houses of prayer. He behaves like, you know, he tries to imitate what other people do. I think that's a very strong image, both powerful and upsetting. And then the encyclopedic nature of his search, you know, he seems to have a method, you know, he sort of tries different things. And finally, the picaresque nature of the tale, but most, I think, significantly perhaps, the poetic nature of his trajectory, which reminded me of the course of a river from the mountain into the sea. So it's, you know, he moves the way a river does. He traces a trajectory of a course of water. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. So just a comment. Yeah. We yeah. Okay. So thank you. The last quite similar. Yeah.
I feel very tempted to challenge the idea that this is about destruction. Because I was thinking that I never seen a cowboy film where the cowboy kills somebody and checks the hole. And in this case, the character drills because he likes the holes, not because he hates the things. Mm-hmm. So let me translate that into something more civic, which is the difference between violence as destruction or emancipation or hatred into violence as expression. Now, the toilet scenes are definitive because one space where violence as expression occupies a central social role is the public toilet, because all those inscriptions are just expression. So the idea of drilling at a hole next to the big hole feels to me as a resistance to the idea of having your shit flushing.